that I, counsel appearing on behalf of petitioner, humbly seek permission to address this honorable bench as your lordships. Much obliged. The counsel seeks permission to proceed with the statement of jurisdiction. Much obliged. The Honorable Supreme Court of India has the jurisdiction to try, entertain and dispose of the present petition under Article 136(1) of the Constitution of India. Would your lordships like a brief summary of facts?
Yes.
Indeed, your lordship. Mr. Rajendra Thomas filed a suit, being special civil suit, dated 16 January 2014 in Humayupura Mahanagara against his niece Mrs. Lisa Kamath, seeking an interim injunction against the suit property. The suit property in question was allotted to him via a consent decree which was finalized by Mrs. Lisa Kamath's mother and Mr. Rajendra Thomas in a consent decree in 2011. In her written statement and reply to the application for interim injunction, Mrs. Kamath in March 2014 claimed that the consent decree is contrary to law in view of a will. According to the will, the suit property had been left by Mr. Birendra Thomas, the original owner of the suit property and the eldest brother of Mr. Rajendra and Mrs. Lisa's mother. However, the will was not executed by Mr. Rajendra during the finality of the consent decree. Mrs. Lisa and her mother discovered about the existence of the will post the issuance of the consent decree. The trial court granted an interim injunction to Mr. Rajendra by its judgment and order dated 7th August 2014. A new advocate was appointed by Mrs. Kamath as the previous advocate was unable to place the correct defense. According to the new advocate, in a new legal opinion, the suit property along with another property belonged to Mrs. Lisa's mother as provided in the will. In an application dated 9th March 2016, Mrs. Lisa Kamath filed a plea to amend her written statement by adding a short concluding paragraph to her existing written statement, which read out as, "The consent decree is a nullity as it is obtained through a fraud on the court and on Mrs. Lisa's mother." The trial court dismissed the application for amendment by holding that Mrs. Lisa has failed the test of due diligence under the proviso to Order 6, Rule 17 of the CPC. Against the aforesaid judgment, Mrs. Kamath filed a writ petition in the High Court of Mahanagara under Article 227 of the Constitution of India. The High Court agreed with the decision of the trial court and dismissed the petition on the basis that Mrs. Kamath had not passed the test of due diligence under the proviso to Order 6, Rule 17 of the CPC. However, the real question and controversy was that the will was obtained fraudulently by Mr. Rajendra as he hid the will, which places the possession of the suit property along with another property to Mrs. Lisa's mother. Mrs. Lisa has therefore preferred her SLP against the above judgment and order of the High Court. The counsel seeks permission to proceed with the issues in the present matter. Much obliged. The issues in the present matter are as follows. The first issue being whether the SLP is maintainable under Article 136 of the Constitution of India. Issue number two, whether an amendment to a written statement can be made in light of a new legal opinion despite due diligence under the proviso to Order 6, Rule 17 of the CPC. Issue number three, being whether the proviso to Order 6, Rule 17 of the CPC applies to an amendment concerning fraud on the court under the second part of the rule, which is the proviso and the mandatory part. And the last and fourth issue being whether Section 4(1) of the CPC prevents a party from filing a case under Section 44 of the Indian Evidence Act and if there were fraudulent actions committed. The counsel seeks permission to proceed with the arguments.
Yeah.
Much obliged. The counsel will be dealing with the first and second issues, while my co-counsel will be dealing with issues number 3 and 4. The first contention raised in the present matter is whether the SLP is maintainable under Article 136 of the Constitution of India. The counsel for the petitioner humbly submits before this Honorable Supreme Court that the SLP is maintainable as the petitioner has the requisite locus standi to file the SLP. The SLP that is filed under Article 136 of the Constitution of India can be entertained by the Supreme Court as it raises a substantial question of law and that the petitioner has been dealt with arbitrarily by the High Court.
What is that substantial question of law which 136 speaks of? Read 136.
Indeed, Your Lordship. Article 136(1) of the Constitution of India reads out as, Notwithstanding anything in this chapter, the Supreme Court may in its discretion grant special leave to appeal from any judgment, decree, determination, sentence or order in any cause or matter passed or made by any court or tribunal in the territory of India.
Your Lordship. The concept, substantial question of law, which occurs in section 100 of CPC, section 30 of workman's compensation, why are you reading it there? Why are you conditioning the power of the Supreme Court under section 136 for the substantial question of law which you have added but not the constitution makers? What is that?
Your Lordship, the Supreme Court, in a plethora of its judgments, the Supreme Court has held that the SLP holds prime importance in the judiciary of India. It is a residuary power which can only be used under special circumstances and exceptional circumstances by the Supreme Court of India. It can only be exercised when cases of substantial question of law arise or where gross injustice has been done to either party by any order, decree, judgment of any court or tribunal.
Court one judgment.
Indeed, Your Lordship.
Yes.
Your Lordship, in the case of Sir Chunilal Mehta and Sons Limited versus Century Spinning and Manufacturing Company Limited, this Honourable Court had laid down the following tests to determine whether a substantial question of law is involved. The tests are, the first test is whether directly or indirectly it affects the substantial right of the parties involved. And the second test is whether the question is of general public importance.
No, that is the judgment to decide what is meant to be a substantial question of law.
Indeed, Your Lordship.
Yes, that is not the question here. I am asking you whether to invoke 136, the existence of substantial question of law as against the important question of law, which is the concept which the Supreme Court has accepted.
If by the order or the judgment of the High Court, if there is a illegality or if there is a wrong opinion which comes into place, it is the duty of the Honorable Supreme Court, if filed under Article 136, to correct this very injustice which is done to the party who is filing the SLP. Another important aspect that the Council would like to throw light on is that under Article 136 is an exceptional power to be exercised with caution and care to remedy very extraordinary and special circumstances. As contended by the Council earlier, in the present matter there are no special or exceptional circumstances because there are ample cases where pleas for amendment of written statements or pleadings in general have been filed after the commencement of trial. Another very important fact in the matter of maintainability that the Council would like to contend is that both the courts in the instant matter, the High Court and the Trial Court, have dealt with Mrs. Lisa in a very arbitrary fashion. The lack of justified reasoning. Your Lordship, the test of due diligence, both the courts agreed on the fact that Mrs. Lisa Kamath failed to adequate due diligence and hence her amendment for the written statement was rejected. Your Lordship, it is however plain that when the Supreme Court reaches the conclusion that a person has been dealt with arbitrarily and there are no justified reasonings given by both these courts, the Trial Court and the High Court, then no technical hurdles of any kind like the finality of finding facts or otherwise can stand in the way of the Supreme Court to exercise its power under Article 136. Hence, it is humbly submitted before the Honorable Supreme Court that the SLP filed by the petitioner is maintainable, as the petitioner has the requisite locus standi to file the SLP and that the courts can entertain the said SLP. If your Lordships are satisfied with the contention, Council would seek permission to...
Just now you said that only in exceptional circumstances can Article 136 be...
Indeed, Your Lordship.
...exercised. What is the exceptional circumstance in the present case? Because two courts are consistently held that the amendment ought not to be permitted.
Your Lordship, the council here is relying on the fact that there was gross injustice done to the petitioner in the present case, not on the there are a lot of circumstances under which a SLP is allowed by the Supreme Court of India. In the present instant matter, it is not the fact that what your lordship just asked. Here, the rights of the parties involved are not getting affected, especially Mrs. Lisa Kamath. Because the High Court, I would like to reiterate on the fact that the High Court as well as the trial court did not give justified reasonings as to why did they reject her plea for amendment. Your Lordship's due diligence, solely on the basis of due diligence, which is just a procedural aspect of Order 6 Rule 17.
It is not only due diligence, but also you have to establish that amendment is absolutely necessary for proper adjudication of the rights of the parties.
Indeed, Your Lordship.
It is only a suit for injunction.
Indeed, Your Lordship.
Defendant need not plea anything. Simply deny the allegations made in the plaint. How this amendment is necessary for adjudication of the rights of the parties.
Your Lordship, in the present matter, the suit property against which for which the injunction simpliciter has been sought for by the respondent is allotted to him via a consent decree.
No, it is left to the plaintiff to amend the plaint.
Pardon me, Your Lordship.
It is left to the plaintiff to amend the plaint for a declaration and other things. It is only a suit for injunction.
Indeed, Your Lordship, but the real question and controversy here between the two parties is the validity of the consent decree in view of the will. Your Lordship, the ownership of the property here, if Mr. Rajendra is asking for an amendment, is asking for an injunction simpliciter to injunction, interim injunction for this a suit property, it has to be established that he is the rightful owner of the suit property. In the instant matter, the ownership of this suit property is itself in dispute. And hence, this amendment made by Mrs. Lisa should be allowed.
That is why the burden is on the plaintiff.
Indeed, Your Lordship.
Not on the defendant.
Indeed, Your Lordship. In the course of my arguments dealing with the second issue, I would like to put lights on those aspects also.
Any issue can be framed on the defendant in an injunction suit.
Pardon me, Your Lordship.
Any issue can be framed, casting the burden on the defendant in a mere injunction suit.
Your Lordship, could you rephrase your question? The counsel failed to understand what Your Lordship is trying to ask.
The issue to be fact in issue is on the defendant to establish and the plaintiff to establish.
Indeed, Your Lordship, what the counsel for the petitioner is seeking from this honorable court is only to allow Mrs. Lisa Kamath to amend her written statement. The counsel agrees with the fact that the burden of proof of proving this fact lies on the petitioner, and the petitioner will do so, but not in the Supreme Court of India.
What's the need for the amendment, ma'am?
Yes, that is what exactly we are.
What is the need for amendment?
Whether any counterclaim is claimed by the defendant in this suit?
Indeed, not, Your Lordship.
Yes.
Your Lordship, an amendment of pleadings post the commencement of trial, there are certain grounds laid down for the same. One of the main grounds for the same is it has to bring in the real question and controversy between the two parties. Only then can such an amendment be allowed. In the present matter, Your Lordship, the counsel agrees with the fact the suit was filed for an interim injunction against the property. But the ownership of the property, who is the real owner of the property, that itself is in dispute. The counsel is not saying it will be proved in the Honorable Supreme Court of India. But if the amendment is granted, the matter will go back to the trial courts, because the trial has commenced, but it is not over yet. This trial for interim injunction is still on. It is still on the cross-examination stage.
What is the amendment you wanted to?
Your Lordship, the amendment?
Yes.
The amendment we are trying to make here is that the consent decree should be nullified, because the will which has been suppressed, it proves there is fraud on the court as well as the petitioner.
What is the fraud on the court? On the petitioner, I can understand. Where is the fraud on the court? Because fraud on the court stands on a different footing. Where is the fraud on the court?
Your Lordship, if you would give me a moment.
Well.
which has been raised in the present issue is whether an amendment to a written statement can be made in the light of a new legal opinion, despite due diligence, under the proviso to Order 6, Rule 17 of the CPC. It is humbly submitted by the counsel for the petitioner in the Honourable Supreme Court that an amendment to a written statement can be made in the light of a new legal opinion under the same proviso. Your Lordship, Order 6, Rule 17 of the CPC provides for amendment of pleadings. It reads out as, the court may at any stage of the proceedings allow either party to alter or amend his pleadings in such manner and on such terms as may be just, and all such amendments shall be made as may be necessary for the purpose of determining the real question in controversy between the parties, provided that no application for amendment shall be allowed after the trial has commenced unless the court comes to the conclusion that in spite of due diligence, the matter could not have been raised before the commencement of trial. For the clarity of this order, Your Lordship, it is very important to understand two concepts, which are the concepts of commencement of trial and the concept of due diligence. It is settled law, Your Lordship, it is a settled fact that a trial commences when the issues of the trial are framed by the court. However, Your Lordship, the crux of this rule is the trial commences. Your Lordship, the trial commences when the issues of the case are framed by the court.
No.
Even before plaintiff enters into the box?
When the first commences. Of the witnesses is called to the box, the trial commences.
Yes.
Unless the law otherwise says.
Your Lordship, once the issues of the matter are framed, post that, Your Lordship, if you would, in the case of Baldev Singh versus Manohar Singh,
yes.
The Supreme Court interpreted the term within the ambit of Order 6, Rule 17, which said that the commencement of trial as used in the proviso must be understood in the limited sense as to meaning of the final hearing of the suit, examination of witnesses and filing of documents and addressing of arguments. Your Lordship, post this, the issues of the case are framed by the court and that is when the trial commences, Your Lordship.
Not post that, pre that. Not post that. Issues are framed.
Read that. Documentation, then examination of the witness,
yes,
and arguments. So, first is documentation and then examination of the witness. So, examination of the witness presupposes that is the stage where exactly the trial starts. That is even according to Baldev Singh's case.
Apologies, Your Lordship. The crux of the rule, however, in general and more so in the
but
instant
ultimately
matter.
In the bottom of the judgment, you read, the court said that evidence is not started.
In the matter of Baldev Singh,
yes,
Your Lordship?
Evidence is not yet started.
Last paragraph.
Indeed, Your Lordship.
Right. Therefore, the trial had not begun.
Indeed. Your Lordship. Apologies. The crux of the rule, however, in general and more so in the instant matter, is the test of due diligence. Your Lordship, due diligence means reasonable diligence. It means the diligence that a prudent man would conduct in his own affairs. In the matter of J. Samuel versus Gattu Mahesh, it was held that due diligence is the idea that reasonable investigation is necessary before certain kinds of reliefs are requested. Duly diligent efforts are a requirement for a party seeking to use the adjudicatory mechanism for any sort of relief. It can be understood, Your Lordships, that the legal obligation of being aware of all the facts relating to the matter and of all the information relating to the case, the obligation of this lies on the parties to the legal proceedings. In the present matter, Your Lordship, Mrs. Lisa had discharged adequate due diligence as she had knowledge of all the facts of the matter, information regarding Mr. Rajendra, and most importantly, the vital documents of the case, Your Lordship. The amendment sought for her, however, is such which could not have been raised prior to the commencement of trial. It is important to note, Your Lordship.
What was your pleading prior to this amendment? Even if the amendment is not allowed, what was your pleading in the written statement? Either mere denial of the right of the plaintiff or you have stated something about the decree?
Your Lordship, in her original written statement, Mrs. Lisa Kamath claimed that the consent decree is contrary to law in view of the will. Your Lordship.
Three minutes.
Your Lordship.
We can grant 3 more minutes to her because she has stated facts. Others did not state facts. Yes.
Your Lordship, in the present matter, Mrs. Lisa Kamath stated in her original written statement that the consent decree is contrary to law in the view of the will. Mrs. Lisa Kamath, it is very important to understand, Your Lordships, it is very difficult for a common man to understand the intricacies and the technicalities of law. And the law itself, Your Lordship, Mrs. Lisa Kamath, especially in the instant matter, Mrs. Lisa Kamath doesn't belong to a very sound financial background, and she is not very well educated. The facts support the same, as she is a primary school janitor in her village. Your Lordship, poor and illiterate litigants are dependent solely on their advocates. The advice given to Mrs. Lisa Kamath by her first advocate was that the consent decree was contrary to law in view of the will. Post this, after filing of the written statement, Mrs. Lisa Kamath could only understand this aspect from the second advocate's point of view, the second legal opinion that she received, that there can be an aspect of fraud which can be involved. It is again important to understand, Your Lordship, Mrs. Lisa Kamath is poor as well as illiterate. Whatever legal doubts or legal technicality she is not aware of, she is solely dependent on that for any sort of legal backup on her advocate.
So these are all facts. Whether we can go into the facts now?
Indeed not, you said, Your Lordship.
That it is only a substantial question of law.
Indeed,
that
Your Lordship.
That should be decided by this bench.
Indeed, Your Lordship. But for the question of due diligence in the present matter, it was very important to involve some facts.
Due diligence, where it is defined?
Your Lordship,
anywhere in any law for the time being in force?
Indeed not, Your Lordship. The terms due diligence have not been defined by any law.
It should be on facts only.
Indeed, Your Lordship, because due diligence depends from case to case. The factor of due diligence is very subjective,
on
Your
facts,
Lordship.
Concurrent findings are there.
Pardon me, Your Lordship.
On facts, concurrent findings are there. On facts, concurrent findings are already there.
Two courts have held against you.
How on facts we can interfere?
Your Lordship.
Under what circumstances on facts the court can interfere?
Your Lordship, for the matter of due diligence, as the counsel already contended, that due diligence is very subjective. Due diligence is a factor that is considered not only in civil cases, but due diligence is something that any party to any kind of any nature of proceeding has to. It might be a case of which involves the SEBI Act, or it might be any other case. Due diligence is what a prudent man, the process that a prudent man has to exercise in his own affairs, and that is the obligation of the same lies to any kind of legal parties of any kind of proceedings, not just civil cases, Your Lordship. Your Lordship.
Yes, thank you. You have done well. Let us see what your colleague says.
Indeed, Your Lordship.
At least you made all your efforts to answer our questions. Good.
Much obliged.
Whether permission is necessary or it is your statutory right.
Permission to?
You said you wanted to permission to address the court.
To make the judges alert.
Permission.
Am I right, brothers?
You have a right to argue.
Yes.
To wake you up, lest you are sleeping.
Wake you up, yes. I stated in a so polished manner, that's all.
Counsel would be dealing with issue 3, which is fraud is an exception to amend under the proviso. But before that, counsel would be stating fraud under section 44 of the Indian Evidence Act. And section 41 of the CPC is not in violation. Section 41 of the CPC and section 44 are in harmony to each other, and they both operate in different spheres of the law. Section 44 is a piece of substantial law, while CPC is a part of procedural law. So section 44 and section 41 is not in violation of each other. Now, your section 44 of the Indian Evidence Act, your it is based on facts. Your in 2007 the will was made. The elder brother Birendra Thomas, he made a will. In 2011, there was a consent decree signed. The brother, Rajendra Thomas, he filed a partition suit. He initiated the partition suit for the property in the present case, but he had a copy of, he had a will which the other party to the consent decree, the other party on the consent decree, she it was in her favor and it was not disclosed to her that there is a will and there were two properties which goes to her, in even the property which is divided in the consent decree and one more property. In 2012, a copy of the will was provided to her, and so the council would be dealing, the council would be proving the intentions of the party, of the respondent. Fraud is an extrinsic collateral act which vitiates the most solemn proceedings of the court of justice. Section 44 enables a party.
Who said this for the first time in the legal history?
A British scholar, I don't have the name, Justin, I remember.
No, you are wrong. What Justin said is something else. You also do not know who said it. Two wrongs you have committed now. Had you said I did not know, only one wrong you would have committed. It was Lord Edward Coke who said this. Okay?
Yes.
All right. But he belonged to England. To that extent, you are right.
But at least he said this before us. He said this before us.
Yes. Yes, proceed.
Section 44 of the Indian Evidence Act enables a party otherwise bound by a previous adjudication to show that it was not final or binding because it is vitiated by fraud. The provision therefore gives jurisdiction and authority to a court to consider and decide the question whether a prior adjudication is vitiated by fraud.
How is section 4 of the CP code applicable here?
Section in the moot problem, section 4.1, the council had to prove section 4.1, which is the saving clause of the CPC, is not in violation of section 44. And so since they operate in different spheres, the party has a right under section 44 to file a case, because section 44 basically deals with if a prior adjudication is, if a prior order or decree is vitiated by fraud, the court and the party under section 44 can file a case against it, and the if the court feels it is...
Read.
Can file a suit.
Read section 44.
Yes.
4 of CPC, 44 of Evidence Act.
Section 44 is only with reference to relevancy.
Yes, relevancy of judgments. Alright, you have quoted them. Read now.
Section 4.1 of the CPC provides that in the absence of any specific provision in the contrary, nothing in the code shall be deemed to limit or otherwise affect any special or local law now in force. And Section 44 of the Indian Evidence Act says fraud or collusion in obtaining judgment or incompetency of court may be proved. Any party to a suit or other proceeding may show that any judgment, order or decree which is relevant under section 40, 41 and 42 and which has been proved by the adverse party was delivered by a court not competent to deliver it or was obtained by fraud or collusion. The council was just trying to prove that they both don't violate each other, and so the court should be the court should allow the council to under section 44 the right under section 44 to fight the case, to argue the case.
Does section 4 and 44 enable you or entitle you to argue the case, or you have an inherent right to argue the case on behalf of your client?
Section 4.1 is a saving clause. Under section 44 we can fight the case.
4 speaks of the power saved in the court.
Yes, sir.
Okay, under special law, local law. All right. Can you say, because you quoted that section, we are asking you, but for that we would not have, what is difference between special law and local law? Because section refers to that concept, those concepts.
Special law deals with a particular section of people. So, if a special act, so Arms Act is a special law, because it deals with a specific provision and
special subjects.
Special subjects of the court.
Local law?
Local law would be a procedural of dealing with many instances of cases. So many other provisions would be included.
No. general law, special law is a law relating to special subjects. Local law has territorial concept. Karnataka, it becomes local law. Maharashtra, it becomes local law. Okay? All right.
The counsel would be coming to the facts here. The appellant could not have discovered about the fact that there was a will left by Brainerd Thomas, and even after their diligence, there was no possible way of knowing the existence of the
sir,
will.
How can you say that your client did not know about the will, because in the first written statement there is a reference to the will?
The knowledge of the will, the copy and the knowledge of the will was provided in the year 2012, while the consent decree.
When is the diligence required? At what time should the diligence be made? There are two points here: when the written statement was filed, and later when an amendment application is filed. Now, diligence is to be established at which of these two points?
It should be with reference to your earlier written statement.
Yes, Your Lordship. In the earlier written statements also, it was specifically, it was proved that the consent decree, we were challenging the consent decree, and it was contrary to law. And
so,
you.
So when the written statement was filed, your client had the knowledge of the will.
Can you rephrase the question?
Your client had knowledge of the will when the written statement was filed. Why couldn't this defense be taken then? Obvious question would be, if there was a will, why did the mother concede on the will?
Yes, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, in the present case, we were fighting about the consent decree, and the time period for the delay was justified. The counsel would be challenging solely on the basis of the consent decree to allow the amendment. Here, there are intentions of fraud. So, Section 17 of the Contract Act defines fraud, and the definitions, this case is a case of active concealment of fact. In active concealment, that there is an effort made from the not disclosing the other party to know about the truth. Here, while the consent decree was being made, Rajendra himself filed a partition suit because he knew there is a will, and he wanted to make believe the other party that consent decree was the way that they could divide the property. And so he took initiative in the partition suit number 197. In Nisrani Dasi versus N. Lal Bose, it was stated, if a decree was obtained by fraud, the court has jurisdiction to treat the decree as nullity and render its effect negatory.
What is that? Read again. Say it again.
It was stated, if a decree was obtained by fraud, the court has jurisdiction to treat the decree as nullity and render its effect negatory. Hmm. It is humbly submitted that a plea of fraud under Section 44 can be raised in a collateral act in the ongoing process, because the court believes that it won't increase the number of litigations and it won't delay justice, and suppression of material fact would also come under the ambit of fraud. In the case C. Naidu versus Jagan, a litigant who approaches a court is bound to produce all documents. If he withholds any document to gain advantages, he would be guilty of fraud. If a party filing a case would withhold information, a very crucial information to the case, because of which the other party has been wronged, it was a wrong on the party, but it would also amount fraud on court, as asked by the Honorable Court.
Changala Varaya Naidu judgment.
Yes, sir. The respondent here had no intentions of disclosing the will, because the will, in the will there were two properties. The current property and one more property of 11,000 square feet, square meters. The respondent didn't want to disclose it because then he would lose out on his part of the property. And Lisa's mother, the appellant's mother, was the beneficiary of both the properties. So the respondent withhold that information. He only disclosed it when the other party came to it came to the knowledge of the other party that there is a will that exists and which would benefit us. After much persuasion, the copy of the will was given. But even while giving the copy, the respondent claimed that it had no legal standing because order 23 of the CPC states that a consent decree cannot be challenged, but a consent decree can only be challenged on the basis of fraud. And here, fraud is being done.
Consent decree or compromise decree? Read the section,
23,
provision.
23 refers to what? Compromise or consent?
And whether there is this difference between these two?
Your Lordship, it's a compromise decree under this.
Yes, right. Proceed. In the suit of the plaintiff, whether the court can say nullify the decree, you are the defendant. You are seeking for nullifying the decree,
yes,
obtained by the plaintiff.
Yes, Your Lordship.
Can it be done in the plaintiff suit? Plaintiff suit is simply for not to alienate. Can the court nullify the effect of the decree in the plaintiff suit?
The original injunction.
Without asking for a counterclaim.
If the court believes there was fraud, then the court in the same proceeding can nullify the consent decree.
No, it can dismiss the suit.
The court,
whether it can simply dismiss the suit or nullify the decree.
The court under its inherent powers can take the matter because the court under the inherent powers believe to meet the ends of justice. Mm-hmm. And so the court can nullify the consent decree under the present.
According to, is a decree to be passed in favor of the defendant?
Yes.
According
virtually.
To you,
yes, sir.
Do you believe that the court must pass a decree in favor of the defendant holding that the decree is a nullity?
In the present case, the court must approve the written statement so the party can go back to the trial court where the present matter.
So is the word approval of the written statement?
That would be the prayer to.
No, you are in the highest, you are before the highest court of,
yes, Your Lordship,
of the country. Where is the word approval of the written statement?
Because in the trial court the matter is still going on, and on that basis to amend the written statement we've come to the
Whether
Supreme
anybody, any court can approve the written statement?
The court can allow the written statement on that basis.
So can allow the written statement?
To amend the written statement.
Amendment application can be allowed.
Yes, Your Lordship.
Your submission.
Yes, Your Lordship. Huh? Your Lordship, the counsel was dealing with the intentions of fraud, and now I'll be dealing why fraud is an exception, the reasons. The council, the earlier council, I was stating that it comes under order 23, order 23, rule 3A, the consent decree part, which has an exception that it can be proved negatory and the court can allow it to be the consent decree to nullify the consent decree under order 23, rule 3A.
23, 3A bars a separate suit for setting aside a compromise decree. That's all. Read.
It is impermissible to directly or indirectly question the lawfulness of a consent decree that has been arrived
by a separate suit.
At a compromise between parties to legal proceedings.
When you are quoting a provision of law,
yes, sir,
you should read the provision.
In the matter of Banwarilal versus C. No, Devi.
Read the provision.
You are only reading the commentary or the judgments. Read that section, that provision.
Just a moment.
Yes. And you have to return the book after purpose is over.
Yes.
No suit shall lie to set aside a decree on the ground that the compromise on which the decree is based was not lawful.
That's all.
So the council would straightly come on.
No, interpret it. What does it say? What is meant by that?
If a decree is fraudulent, can you still say that it is lawful, or can you say it is unlawful? If
that would
unlawful,
be unlawful.
Then you know section 23.3a is a bar to filing.
Bar to filing.
Isn't it? Therefore, how do you justify the amendment?
So, fraud being unlawful, that it bars the second
suit.
But here it's the same collateral suit, and the original suit was the interim order.
You have not filed the suit. You are defending a
yes,
suit.
Yes, you are only
that's
defending.
The defense that is available,
yes,
isn't
sir.
It? Please go ahead.
In the matter of Rajesh Kumar Agarwal versus KK Modi, the court has held the provision under first part of Rule 17 is discretionary, but the second part is mandatory and enjoin the court to allow all amendments which are necessary for the purpose of determining the real question in controversy between the parties. In the instant matter, the consent decree has been obtained under fraud, and that is the real question in controversy. The will places the possession of the suit property to Lisa, the appellant. Since the consent decree was obtained by fraud, it should be set aside. The Supreme Court has also held a fraud puts an end to everything. It is the settled position in law that such decree is nothing but a nullity. And amendment by the court is also allowed if prima facie the applicant is a aggrieved party. Here, the party is has been denied of the right to has been denied the will that they should have been in the knowledge of the will before the consent decree. The mother didn't know about the will while filing the consent decree, so they don't meet in the same lines, because the mother thought the consent decree was the only way she could get the property or part of the property. And so on the face of it, the applicant is an aggrieved party, and even if the amendment is allowed, the respondent has to prove it in the trial court.
Sir, one final question. By asking amendment, what are you asking the court to do? A, are you asking the court to declare it as unlawful? B, are you asking the court to ignore it?
The consent decree to the council is asking the court to for the consent decree to be a nullity before the court, and through amendment, if the will the genuinity of the will can be fought in the trial court, if the amendment is approved, this the respondent would have to prove it in
so
the trial.
You are asking the court to declare it as unlawful
or nullity,
not to ignore it,
the nullity, the consent decree.
No. A, you want the court to declare it as an unlawful decree, or do you want the court to ignore it while deciding the controversy?
Oh, unlawful.
You want that's the prayer, that's the amendment that you have sought for.
In the present matter, the amendment, if the court allows the written statement, the trial court, the matter would be put up, and in the trial court...
No, no, what is the prayer sought for in the amendment?
What is your amendment? What is that amendment?
What do you want the court to do?
What is the prayer sought
unlawful for the and consider that fraud was being done. Even in
let us see what others will say.
Yes, proceed. Conclude.
You can conclude.
Under Order 8, Rule 2, the court says fraud should be specifically pleaded. And here, if the amendment is allowed by the court, the party would be able to plead the section of fraud. It is humbly submitted before the Honorable Supreme Court that Lisa should be allowed to amend the written statement. Since not only does it bring out the real question and controversy, but it was vitiated with fraud, the counsel would go to the prayer.
Is there any other forum to challenge that decree by you? Though it bars under Section 3A,
it would,
Rule 3A.
It would violate the principle of res judicata because the trial is already...
That is what I am asking you. Is there any other forum to challenge the decree? Because it is vitiated by fraud, according to you.
If a case
can you challenge that decree in any other manner before any other forum?
No, Your Lordship.
It's final.
Final. Your if it is final, what is the next course?
The consent.
Wherever the law says that particular order or a decree or judgment is final.
The question is if the party can file a case against the consent decree in any other court. So if the party has been gone in the trial...
No, you can take one more minute.
In examination, no copying, but here in court you can copy.
You can.
No problem.
Sir, this is open book examination.
Yes.
So the counsel would again say under Section 11, the... res judicata.
According to you, you cannot file a suit.
While the ongoing proceeding is going on,
Whether the decree can be challenged in any other forum, in any other manner, if it is vitiated by fraud.
It would go under the High Court also, but it's a SLP directly in the Supreme Court. And so, while the trial is ongoing, we can't file a case.
Yes, we know your prayer now. Let us see what they say.
Yes.
Okay?
Thank
your
you.
Opponents.
Greetings to the bench. If it may so please this honourable court, the counsel would like to collectively refer to the bench as your lordships. Much obliged, your lordship. Your lordship, this is the...
You can address us as you want, except insulting us.
Certainly, your lordship.
Or irritating.
Irritation will tolerate.
You can also...
No issue.
Irritate, you can tolerate.
Yes, irritation is not a contempt.
Your Lordship, this is the counsel representing the respondent in the matter of Mrs. Lisa Kamath versus Rajendra Thomas. If your Lordships are well satisfied with the statement of jurisdiction and facts of the case at hand, the counsel would like to move on to the arguments advanced.
Yes, it is left to you.
Certainly, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, this case has been broken down into three issues. The present counsel will be dealing with the first issue at hand, wherein my co-counsel will be dealing with the second and third issue at hand. Your Lordship, the first issue reads as, whether a new legal opinion can be a factor in determining the test of due diligence under the Provisio to Order 6, Rule 17. Your Lordship, the first issue will be dealt with in a manner where the council will establish that the amendment sought by the petitioners on the ground of a new legal opinion should not be allowed, as one, it does not qualify the test of due diligence specified under the Provisio to Order 6, Rule 17. Secondly, there can be no distinction between the party's due diligence and the advocate's due diligence. And thirdly, that adherence to this provisio is mandatory, and thus, therefore, this amendment should not be allowed. Coming to the first sub-issue at hand, Your Lordship, that there is no qualification under the test of due diligence. Your Lordship, there is no dispute in the facts at hand that there has been commencement of trial. Hence, the provisio does come into play where first there must be an examination or a registration of test of due diligence, and then only an amendment can be sought to file. From the council's arguments, the council will establish that the test of due diligence in this case has not been qualified, as the council does not, as the appellant in this case does not exercise due diligence in the matter. As per Valchandra Nagar Industries Limited versus Indraprastha Developers, which is flag 4 in the compendium supplied to the bench, it is the test. The court has given certain guidelines as to what test of what diligence may be in a case at hand. For example, Your Lordship, it was observed in this case that due diligence determines the scope of the party's constructive knowledge of the claim, and it was also observed that due diligence is distinct from ignorance. So, Your Lordship,
what is meant by constructive knowledge, which you are mentioning?
Yes, Your Lordship.
How you can impute that to the defendant in this?
Certainly, Your Lordship. If the bench would refer to para 3 of the fact sheet provided to us, the para 3 brings forth to us what the original written statement was. And the original written statement does go on to say that they purport that the consent decree was contrary in view of the will. Therefore, here what the council wants to say is that the council had all, the appellant had all knowledge and information about the claim before the commencement of trial. The appellant does not bring forth any new matter after the commencement of trial which the appellant could not have brought forth before the commencement of trial. The written statement provided originally does purport to say that all necessary information that the appellant could have had in this matter, it already has. Therefore, no new matter is being brought forth after the commencement of trial, which, as under the provisio, would be necessary to allow an amendment.
That what happened to my question?
Yes, Your Lordship. Yes. If Your Lordship would repeat your question again.
Yes, very well. I will repeat with your permission.
Sorry.
What is difference between constructive knowledge and actual knowledge? So to make it easy, constructive notice and actual notice.
Yes, Your Lordship. Constructive knowledge would go on to say information that the appellant should have and would have in the matter at hand. That would be constructive knowledge in the case. For example, since the in addition to the fact would be that constructive knowledge would go on to mean that all information that would be derived logically or that would be derived from the present matter at hand, that would go on to mean constructive knowledge. As the council was saying, that constructive knowledge in this case, the appellant had before the commencement of trial. Appellant had all the opportunity to bring forth this matter before the commencement of trial, and all because the fact sheet clearly states that whatever information they got was before the commencement of trial, which is in 2012. Therefore, my argument goes on to state that since the appellant has failed the test of due diligence, this amendment cannot be allowed in their favor, since the provisio is mandatory in nature.
What is first part of the provision says?
Your Lordship, the first part
All
of
right,
the provision.
Second part due diligence.
Yes, Your Lordship.
The first part.
The first part says
whether
that court
spite
may
of, whether in spite of the parties not exercising due diligence, if the court feels that the amendment is an absolutely necessary for rightful adjudication, proper adjudication of the rights of the parties, whether still the court is debarred from entertaining the application and allowing
your,
the application.
Your Lordship, the counsel would like to bring forth attention to the case Vidyabai versus Padmalata, which is cited as first in the compendium, that there is a mandatory adherence to the provisio. While the council does not agree that the first part goes on to give power to the court to allow any amendment that they deem so fit, however, after the commencement of trial, which is not in dispute in this matter, after the commencement of trial, there is an embargo on the embargo on this power by stating that only and only if the registration of due diligence or if the court recognizes that due diligence has been followed, only will they then allow the amendment in this case. So, Your Lordship, as the counsel was...
Does it not amounts to allowing the parties to litigate further in before some other forum?
Pardon, Your Lordship?
Does it not amounts to allowing the parties to litigate before some other forum?
Your Lordship...
So, ultimate object of amendment is to lessen the litigation there itself.
Yes, Your Lordship. While that is the legislative intent of this this provision, what the council would say for the present case in hand, and also another aspect of the legislative intent, is to not allow any prejudice to be caused to the party after the commencement of trial.
But what prejudice that is going to be caused to you?
Your Lordship, there are several instances of prejudice that will be caused to the respondent. However, that is going to be dealt with by my co-counsel in the issues 2nd and 3, where she will provide a elaborative stance on the matter. However, the counsel goes on to continue that yes,
what is meant by prejudice? Tell us how you are, second part is how you are going to suffer prejudice. What is meant by prejudice?
Your Lordship, the
prejudice. So amendment application is filed. You are provided with an opportunity to file objections. Court has heard the matter, reasoned out, rejected the application, and then in the appellate court also heard the matter, opportunity provided. How you are prejudiced? In what manner? What is meant by prejudice?
Your Lordship, herein prejudice would mean that any wrongful gain or any bias caused to the other party because of bringing in any amendment. And to answer the second part of Your Lordship's question,
what they are going to gain?
Permission to ask a question?
Yes.
What the appellant is going to gain from adding this amendment?
Yes.
Your Lordship, that the appellant seeks to add this amendment.
Real fraud was there. So it will be dismissed at the most. And you have not sought for any declaration for declaring that you are the owner or acquired right title over the property by means of that decree.
Your Lordship,
the court cannot say anything about that because it is only a suit for mere injunction.
Yes, Your Lordship.
At the most, suit can be dismissed.
Yes, Your Lordship. What the counsel wants to say to this matter is that firstly, yes, there will be prejudice caused, which will be elaborated by my co-counsel, and also this,
Look at us, don't look at it.
Apologies, Your Lordship. Also this amendment, also if this amendment is allowed and the counsel would go back to its primary contention, is that herein the test of due diligence to be qualified prima facie on the fact of the on the facts has to be acknowledged, or that this test has to be qualified in order to allow this amendment. Other considerations, while important, must be secondary in allowing an amendment. Therefore, if the test of due diligence is not qualified, which the council established that it has not, the appellant does not have a chance, or it shouldn't be allowed this amendment in the first place. Your Lordship, the another contention that the council seeks to bring forth is that there can be no distinction between between a client and an advocate's due diligence. Whatever a advocate does is in the name and favor of the appellant itself. And Your Lordship, the argument that a new legal opinion can be used to bring in an amendment is somewhat tending to wriggle out of the provisions of the provisio of Order 6, Rule 17, wherein if the appellant is not satisfied with this new legal opinion,
One more opinion you will take.
Yes, the appellant will go on to seek another new legal opinion and on that grounds would want to amend its written statement consecutively.
Application for amendment.
Yes, Your Lordship.
Any number of applications she can file. Go on.
Yes, Your Lordship. Which is why the legislative intent of this 2002 amendment was to curb this kind of a situation. And this is exactly what we contend in the case at hand. That since there is a need to curb.
You, what is the due diligence she has not exercised?
Yes, Your Lordship. Due diligence has to be. Once we understand the definition of due diligence, it has to be looked in a correlating manner as to if the test of due diligence is qualified, and the test under this proviso is whether this matter could have been brought forth before the commencement of trial in spite of exercise of due diligence.
Which matter?
Any matter that the counsel, any matter that the appellant wants to bring forth
in
through this amendment.
In the case on hand, which matter could have been brought before?
In the case at hand, what? By inferring from their request for amendment that there was suppression of a will. Your Lordship, this suppression of a will, this alleged suppression of a will, the counsel, the appellant already had information of and has brought forth. So no new fact or matter is being brought forth after the commencement of trial which would give grounds for such amendment.
When she had the knowledge of this will?
In 2012, Your Lordship.
Before filing the written statement or after?
Yes, Your Lordship. The new injunction suit that was filed was in 2014. As per our facts, which would be known from para 3 or 6 or 7, the counsel, the appellant had prior knowledge before the filing of its written statement in 2014 because the appellant's mother and the appellant herself got to know of this alleged suppression of a will in 2012 only. Furthermore, Your Lordship.
But they did not have copy of the will.
Your Lordship, in fact, they did get the copy of the will before filing of the 2014 written statement.
But the basic question is, did your client suppress the will in the earlier suit? Did he have knowledge of that will? And did he, despite that knowledge of that will, suppress it?
Your Lordship, to that, the counsel would like to contend.
Would that not tantamount to fraud?
Fraud.
On the court.
Your Lordship, to that the counsel would like to contend that the primary issue of this hearing for amendment application is whether this application can be allowed on the grounds of adherence to the provisio that has been provided under the rule of amendment
so
of pleadings.
You want to take a technical view on the whole matter? I want us to take a technical view on the whole
yes,
matter?
Yes, Your Lordship, because it is mandatory to adhere to this provisio, which has been...
You answer the question in a sealed cover.
Pardon, Your Lordship.
can answer that question in a sealed cover.
This is highest court of the country.
Yes, Your Lordship.
It is not only court of law, but it's a court of justice also. That's how 125 crore people look at us. Okay. So when a question is posed to you and you know the answer, you are not entitled to withhold the answer. If you can finish
yes.
your answer. My Lord, so I do not know anything.
No, Your Lordship.
Yes.
The counsel is in no way trying to withhold an answer.
We have no instructions. We have no instructions so far as that aspect is concerned.
You can safely say that. The counsel is not trying to withhold an answer. However, the counsel would like to bring in the fact that while there is evaluation as to whether an amendment should be allowed, the Supreme Court itself has suggested that there is no need to go into the merits of the allegation.
No, 136 gives fullest power to the court.
Yes, Your Lordship.
And we can also invoke 142.
Yes, Your Lordship. The counsel would still like to
you contend. Understood. We can also invoke 142. You know what 142 of the Constitution says?
Yes, Your Lordship. Permission to continue with my...
Yes, please. Yes.
Yes, Your Lordship.
Yes, okay.
Permission.
Don't be disturbed with our questions. Please proceed.
Most of these questions are to ourselves.
Thank you, Your Lordship.
Or to the brother judges.
So to conclude this council's argument, which will be further elaborated by my co-counsel, the council primarily contends that this amendment cannot be granted because it does not qualify the test of due diligence. And further, the council, since the council has proved that there is no distinction between both these parties' due diligences and that adherence to this proviso is mandatory, the court in its discretion should not allow this amendment at hand. Now I would like to invite my co-counsel for further arguments.
All the proceedings.
Yes, Your Lordship.
But we should only confine ourselves to 6 Rule 17.
Yes, Your Lordship. The proposition that Your Lordship has stated, the council is well aware of that fact. But my co-counsel would elaborate on whatever contention we are basing our case on. Thank you, Your Lordship. This is the counsel from the respondent side. The counsel would, the present counsel would be dealing with issue number 2 and issue number 3. Issue number 2 is whether the proviso under second part of the Rule 17 of Order 6 applies to an amendment concerning fraud on the court and whether such amendment is necessary to determine the real question in controversy between the parties. The counsel would be dealing with the issue in this the present issue in twofold manner. First, the counsel would humbly contend that the amendment should not be given, the application for amendment in the written statement should not be given because it causes grave injustice to the respondent.
Because you will retain the property which you obtained by fraud.
The council...
They are not admitting that they have played fraud.
The council to further the argument that why if the amendment is given will cause injustice to the respondent would bring in 2 points. The first point is that if the amendment is given, it changes the whole nature of the suit. Basically an injunction suit is only to decide the possession of the title, and if an amendment.
Possession
of the property.
Position or possession?
Possession of the property.
Possession of the property. Okay.
Moving forward, Your Lordships. Basically, an injunction suit is to determine the possession of the property. But if the amendment is given and if it allows to contest the legality of the consent decree, then the nature of the suit will change.
A small question to you. Have you founded your suit on the basis of the decree?
Yes, Your Lordship.
Yes. If that is so, can't I show to the court that this decree is vitiated by fraud? And it is a nullity, therefore it cannot be, the suit could not have been founded on that.
Yes, Your Lordship, the appellant can show. But here, even though the fact was, the appellants were well aware of the fact, even before the filing of the first written statement, they didn't bring that to the notice of the court. Whereas after 2 years, they brought an amendment to the written application to bring in a new legal aspect of fraud. Which is
Can a thief say, police should have caught me long before? No, lot of time has spent and now you cannot arrest me?
Your Lordship, no forum or court as the trial court, up until this point, the respondent is the de jure purposes. According to the fact sheet in para 2, Rajendra Thomas has the purported title and de jure possession over the said suit property. Based on the consent decree, no court or no forum as till now held that the consent decree was vitiated by fraud. So we would be considering that the consent decree is still valid, and we would be arguing on that point. Moving on with the arguments, one of the basic points that need to be addressed here is why the 2002 amendment was brought in the first place, the legislative intent of the 2002 amendment. If an amendment to a written statement is given on the basis of a new legal opinion, there would be plethora of cases where in after every 2 or 3 years, a new legal opinion that the party could come with a new legal opinion and asking for a new legal aspect to be added, which would increase the time taken for the suit, and which would also increase the multiplicity of the proceedings.
Can't be legal point raised even without amendment.
Your Lordship?
Can't the defendant raise a legal, according to you, he want to raise legal point, right? Can't he raise it even without an amendment? Without an amendment to written statement, whether any party can raise the legal point before the court to be adjudicated? Law point.
Yes, Your Lordship, but in the present...
If it is a question of law, whether court is bound to answer that even without it is pleaded by the parties?
Yes, Your Lordship, but in the present case...
No, say yes or no. Say yes or no.
No, Your Lordship, yes. No, Your Lordship, no legal...
No, the court should not adjudicate unless it is pleaded, even though it is pure question of law.
Your client appears to be behind.
Yes, proceed.
Moving on with the further arguments. The legislative intent of 2002 amendment was that multiplicity of the pleadings and also the time taken if an amendment is given will be increased. So there was a mandatory proviso added that if a party is asking for an amendment to a written application after the commencement of the trial, they should follow the test of due diligence. As my co-counsel presented that the appellant has failed to adhere to the test of due diligence, it is contended that the Honorable Supreme Court should not give an application for the written statement to amend.
But your co-counsel said you will argue on the question of prejudice.
Yes.
You have still not enlightened us on that.
What prejudice?
What prejudice would be caused if the amendment is allowed?
Yes, Your Lordship. The prejudice and the injustice caused on us if the amendment is allowed is that the nature of the suit changes from that of an injunction suit to contesting the legality of a consent decree, which would bring us back to the place where the partition of the suit will be again in question. So since it changes the nature of the suit, that would cause us injustice and prejudice.
How does...
No, it is your suit. How it changes your suit?
If the amendment is given, then it changes our suit.
How it changes your suit?
If the...
It is not the pleading sought to be amended to the plaint. It is to the written statement. How it changes your case? It may change the case of the defendant.
If the amendment is allowed, it would basically say that they can say that the consent decree is a nullity and fraud on court was committed. So this would mean that the since our injunction suit is based on the consent decree, this would get us back to the original place where we were before filing of an injunction suit. In that way, it would cause us prejudice and injustice. And also the other point that needs to be highlighted is that the delay they made to bring the application to amend the written statement, though they were aware of the facts in 2012, the amendment to the written application was done in 2016. So this delay can also be considered as an injustice and prejudice to the respondent.
If it is a case of fraud, the consistent view of the courts in all civilized jurisdictions is no question of delay.
Yeah, indeed, Your Lordship. After the knowledge of the fraud, if a party has the knowledge of the fraud, the Limitation Act says that within 3 years it should be brought to the the matter should be brought in front of the court. But it has been 4 years and the matter has application to written statement has been brought now.
That fraud is on party.
Yes.
Limitation Act fraud, which section I think 17 of the Limitation Act speaks of, is fraud on other party. But this is fraud on the court.
Is there any limitation to bring it to the notice of the court that fraud was played on court?
No, Your Lordship, there is no limitation to bring in the fact that the fraud has been committed on the court, whereas unnecessary delay also should be taken into consideration without any proper explanation. And the appellants have not given a proper reason for the delay they have caused, which was held in... Which was held in Kamala Bala Biswas versus Kala Chandra Sarkar, that however, where no explanation is offered for the reasons of delay, it would not be just and proper to allow the amendment at any stage.
So we cannot complain that fraud was committed when Alexander had come here. Is it not? There should be some time limit for that also. Okay.
Indeed, Your Lordship.
What, according to you, is the real controversy in the matter, madam?
The next contention is the same.
What is the real controversy in this
matter? Since the present suit is for an injunction, the main controversy between the party is who possesses the property. But if the amendment is allowed, it changes the nature of the suit. So this amendment is not necessary to determine the real question in controversy between the party. That is the contention from the respondent side.
But are you not relying upon the decree that you have obtained to justify your injunction? And if so, cannot the other side contend that that decree which was obtained was a nullity, being vitiated by fraud?
Indeed, Your Lordship, but the arguments earlier submitted that the delay caused, and if it is allowed, then the nature of the suit will be changed. And even though that the other party has not passed the test of due diligence, and this would cause injustice to the party, these all arguments would bring in the point that even though the party has a right to say that the consent decree was vitiated by the fraud, these four arguments would bring in the point that the amendment should not be allowed. The council would like to move on to the third issue at hand. The third issue is whether a party has a right under Section 44 of the Indian Evidence Act to show that a prior consent decree was vitiated by fraud, and whether such
Why all of you are using consent decree? Though the statute says it is compromise decree.
Is there a difference between the two?
Courts differ. Some courts have said there is difference,
other courts also differ.
We always known for difference. Difference and deference, both.
The council used the word consent decree because in the proposition it was mentioned as consent decree. Basically, the third issue is whether a party has a right under Section 44 of Indian Evidence Act to show that a prior consent decree was vitiated by fraud, and whether such right is being saved by Section 41 of CPC, so that the proviso to Order 6, Rule 17 would not come in the way of an amendment. It is humbly contended that a party has no right under Section 44 of Indian Evidence Act to show that a prior consent decree was vitiated by fraud.
What is the nature of right under Section 44? Available to a party, if it's available.
Section 44 is basically talks about relevancy of facts, and section
relevancy of
relevancy of facts.
No, judgments.
Correct. Relevancy of facts is reference to
judgment. No, relevancy of judgments.
Correct. Entire chapter deals with relevancy of facts.
That's all. From 6 to 52, all right. But what is judgments?
No, we agree with you. Relevancy of facts, okay, we agree with you. Proceed. Because chapter refers relevancy of facts.
Indeed, Your Lordship.
Yes.
The council contends that the party has no right under Section 44 of Indian Evidence Act, basically because Section 44 basically mentions that a party has a right to show that the judgment, any judgment, order, decree is relevant under, which is relevant under Section 40, 41 or 42 of Indian Evidence Acts was obtained by fraud. In order to have a right under Section 44, any judgment, decree should be relevant under Section 40, 41 or 42. The council.
This relevancy of facts, whether it should be brought before the court only by way of pleadings or in the course of evidence also.
In the course of evidence also, Your Lordship.
All right. Let us take that the defendant has not filed any written statement.
Yes,
he brings it to the notice of the court during the course of cross examination of the plaintiff that the fraud has been played on the court. Whether the court is prevented from considering that?
Yes, Your Lordship, because fraud should be specifically pleaded.
Fraud on court. It is brought to the notice of the court in the course of cross examination of the your client. Whether court can shut his eyes because defense has not been taken, therefore I don't consider this cross examination. Let us take no written statement has been filed. Supreme Court says that even we have delivered so many judgments that even without filing the written statement, party can cross examine the witness plaintiff on the basis of the pleadings of the plaintiff on the evidence led by the plaintiff himself. So in the evidence of the plaintiff, it is elicited that fraud has been played on the court. Whether the court is prevented from looking into that portion of the evidence because of there is no pleading. If your answer is yes, the court can consider, the amendment will not prejudice you.
Your Lordship, the point here is that the appellants have filed for a separate application for written amendment stating that they want to plead fraud specifically. So we are contending in opposition to that, that the amendment should not be given.
Let them prove otherwise. Let them prove the fraud otherwise. You cannot prevent them.
But Order 23, Rule 3 has a bar to say that the consent decree was vitiated by fraud. So the only way for them is to plead in the written statement that the fraud was specific, to plead fraud specifically.
All right, you have to stand on your legs so far as the decree is concerned. That you are before the court, not the defendant.
Indeed, Your Lordship.
You have to establish that the decree is valid in the initial stages.
Indeed, Your Lordship, up until the present moment, the decree is still valid because of the decree passed by the during the partition suit. The para 2 of the fact sheet says a consent decree date was a property of 12,000 square meters was allotted to him under a consent decree dated 14/7/2011 in a partition suit filed by him against his sister. And this, according to this consent decree, this which is still valid, which has not been contested in any court or any forum, is still valid, and the our client is still the de jure possessor of the property. The council now would like to move on to the further arguments. The council contends that a party has no right under Section 44 of Indian Evidence Act because the ingredients of Indian Section 44 of Indian Evidence Act is not met. To meet the ingredients, the appellant has to prove that the present case falls under Section 40, 41 or 42 of Indian Evidence Act. Section 41 basically speaks about justices in judgments in rem, which the true...
No, 41, leave it. Go to 40.
Section 40 basically speaks about the existence of a judgment, decree or order is a relevant fact if by the law it has the effect of preventing any court from taking cognizance of a suit or holding a trial. It is intended to include all cases which generally falls with a general law relating to res judicata.
What is res judicata?
Res judicata is a principle which prohibits the same parties to come to the court with the same matter again, which is defined under which is defined in Section 11 of CPC.
Madam, you refer to Order 23, Rule 3, Capital A. How would you respond if the court were to ask you? Order 23, Rule 3A applies to the plaintiff, not to the defendant. Therefore, don't defend the order on that basis.
Order 23, Rule 3, 3A applies to a suit, not to the defendant. A suit is essentially by the plaintiff. Therefore, don't rely upon that. If the court were to tell you, how would you respond?
Don't rely upon Section 40?
23, capital 3A.
Because it applies to a plaintiff, not to the defendant.
They have not filed the suit.
But they are the one who want to contest the consent decree, and Section 23, Rule 3A would apply to them because it bars.
No, it's not their suit.
It is not their suit.
In your suit, they are entitled to show. Otherwise, section would have been worded in a different way, as you wanted now.
Indeed, Your Lordship, the counsel didn't seem to understand the question. Can you...
They have not sought for any counterclaim in their written statement for a declaration that declares that the decree is invalid. It is just to bring to the knowledge of the court that the decree is vitiated by fraud. They have not filed any suit.
It is your suit.
As such, for any declaration to declare that the decree is fraudulent, null and void. It is only they are using it as shield, not as a sword.
Because Order 23, Rule 3A bars them to directly or indirectly question the lawfulness of a consent decree.
Read 23, 3A.
Question Nanti Janari.
No separate suit shall lie. That is how the section begins. They are not filed. It is your suit.
Indeed,
they want to resist your suit.
Yes.
No defendant shall resist the suit by taking up X, Y, Z factors on which a contract can be voided. That is not the wording.
Indeed, Your Lordship, that is what the counsel needs to contend, that since they are barred from filing a new suit, to contest the consent decree through a new suit, they are using their malafide intention to bring in the amendment after a long period of time to make to bring in a new legal aspect of fraud to gain illegal advantage. That is what the counsel wants to contend.
In other words, you want to say the word suit, although suit is not defined in CPC, it only says section 25, 26 says that suit is instituted by presentation of the plaintiff, except that there is no definition. You want to say that the suit should be understood as a dispute so that they also cannot raise such a dispute.
Simply
answer.
Yes to him. Say simply yes.
Yes, Your Lordship.
Yes.
That's the best way to win a case.
The judge.
Yes.
The second contention is that Section 44 of Indian Evidence Act is not saved by Section 41 of CPC and the criminal cases. So, since it can't be proved that Section 44 of Indian Evidence Act is a special or a local law, Section 41 of CPC would not save Section 44 of Indian Evidence Act. So the provisio to Order 6, Rule 17 would come in the way of an amendment.
On Section 4, all five of us are not agreed that it can be invocable.
Yes.
We are all with you.
No difference.
Section 44 of Indian Evidence Act does not enact any rule relating to the substantive right possessed by a citizen, nor does it enumerate and exhaust the grounds upon which a decree or order may be attacked. If fraud or collusion vitiates the order or decree passed by a civil court, there does not appear to be any ground for holding that it does not or cannot make inoperative or nugatory an order passed by the court in a partition proceedings. This was
that
held
goes
in
against you. The second part which you have read, it runs counter to your argument.
It reads that Section 44 does not exactly or specifically says that it has a party has a substantive right to show that the consent decree was vitiated by fraud.
Then come to Section 5 of Evidence Act. The court has got power to allow the parties to plead and prove the relevant facts. right, whether it is section 5 or not.
Section 5 says leading of evidence to prove the facts in issue.
Yeah,
the facts relevant to the facts in
issue. Where the court permits.
Nothing else.
Section 6.
The court permits. 6.
Given in any suit or proceedings of the existence or non-existence of every fact in issue and of such and of such other facts as are hereinafter declared to be relevant and of no others.
Yes. Yes. It is provided under the law itself to be pleaded and proved, the which are relevant for the purpose of that particular case. Now go to say, what is the evidence?
Statements which the court permits or requires to be made before it by witnesses in relation to matters of fact under inquiry, such statements are called oral evidence. The second part of the definition says all documents including electronic records produced for the inspection of the court. Such
yes.
documents are called documentary evidence.
Court can permit the oral evidence on relevant facts. They are only seeking that.
A document is a document.
The counsel would ask, what is the question, Your Lordship?
The judgment is a document now. Judgment taken by you by means of that compromise decree is a judgment, is it not? Under section 44, the judgment is relevant. The court can permit the parties to produce that document either by you or the other party and plead and prove with reference to that document. Why the court should not permit them to plead that?
No, how section 44 is invocable? Nobody is pressing into service the judgment at all. It is your judgment which you have founded the suit on. Is it not? How 44 is invocable?
Your Lordship, the whole contention from the respondent side is that section 44 is not invocable and
No. They say they want to bring home a particular fact which will show to the court that the judgment on which you have founded the suit is obtained by fraud. So for 44 as such is not invocable. It becomes invocable where a judgment is put as a piece of evidence before the court. Why 44?
Indeed, Your Lordship, that is the argument of the respondent as well, that
no,
section...
She did not catch you.
No, she has understood it. She is answering it.
Yes.
That's right.
The argument of the respondent is that
says 44 was not invocable by other side.
That the whole point of the argument from the respondent side is that we didn't invoke section 44 of Indian Evidence Act. It was invoked by appellant. We are here to refute that the section for the party has no right under section 44 and the counsel.
I don't think they are claiming any right under that provision. Right has to be decided, but just they want to bring it to the notice of the court. That's all, a particular fact.
That your judgment is bad.
Which is a relevant fact. According to the Evidence Act also, it is a relevant fact. They want to bring it to the notice of the court. Whether the court has to permit it under Section 3. Section 3 says that it shall be permitted.
They did not specifically mention that they are bringing our judgment as an evidence under section 44 of the Indian Evidence Act.
No, you lead evidence. They are simply saying that. No, don't rely upon this decree. That's all.
Because it is vitiated. You want to study and come back?
Next year.
So that we will have some relief.
Good, you have answered all the questions almost.
Made all efforts.
The counsel would now like to move to the prayer.
Prayer is known to us, so don't worry.
Now we have to make a prayer. Give relief to us. Okay, well done. All you have done.